I love video games. I love the medium's ability to tell engaging stories over a longer time frame than films. It's a massive industry that has put forth beautiful works of art created by thousands of artists within both larger corporations and independent studios. But most importantly, the video game industry has given us some of the best soundtracks from some of the world's most prolific composers. Because it is a comparatively young art form, the music in modern video games has taken a lot of its cues from film. It makes a lot of sense when you think about it. After all, the video in video game refers to the fact that it is mostly absorbed through the eyes. And it's safe to assume that the general audiences for most entertainment mediums will be used to the way that storytelling is done in films. Here's the thing, even though video games share a lot of DNA with other entertainment forms, they have very different rules when it comes to effective musical storytelling.
Hey, that's the title of the video!
A good place to start might be in these areas where film scores and video game scores kind of overlap. I think one of the most prominent overlapping features is theme songs. The power of a good theme in a film has been thoroughly explored by smarter people than I on better YouTube channels, but the gist is that it is a vital part of how films set the tone for what is to come in the next 2 to 3 hours. Ooh, but wait, now you have to set the tone for the next 8 to 50 hours. The way composers do this is by establishing a recurring piece of music early on that represents the overarching theme of your story or experience. And I believe the cleverness of a theme is not only when it is established, but when it is repeated. Music is all about repetition, and video games are no different. The music that John Powell did for the How to Train Your Dragon franchise, an excellent franchise, is a tapestry of themes and motifs that beautifully support the locations, the characters, and the connections between them, and all the music is masterfully introduced in the opening of the film. The strength of one of the main themes of the film, titled Test Drive, lies within the fact that we've heard many of its components before. Sideways did an absolutely incredible video on this topic that you should watch after this, and many of the more clever video games do something similar with their title music. Different developers elect to make different choices as to when we are introduced to these themes, whether it be the opening of the game itself or the main menu on startup, a weaker method if you ask me, but one that has been utilized by many of the best games. Either way, the establishment of one's score is just as important as the establishment of one's world. This might even be more important for video games than it is for film, because immersion is such a key part of the appeal. Main themes tend to be the most well-remembered parts of music from a piece of media, because it will not only be used in promotion, but be heard every time you start up the game. It's a lot like how sometimes the first song on an album will become your favorite, because
repetition legitimizes.
Now, after establishing tone, how can we further support the story? In all fairness, I should say that story often takes a severe backseat to gameplay. After all, we've elected to interact with this media, I'm not watching a film. Now, there are exceptions to this. Some video games have shown that long-form storytelling can be an incredible tool. But when I say that some, if not most, stories in video games are average at best, I'm not hating. I think it serves as a further testament to the fact that music can make something stick the landing way better. There are some films that, critically at least, are not good films, but have bloody excellent scores. Good music can almost trick you into remembering stories fondly, but because story is kind of secondary for most video games, the music now has to try and support two sometimes conflicting ideas. Here's what I mean. There are some rules that film composers follow that wouldn't really work if translated directly to a different medium. In film, usually, you'll have a series of events that will be put to music later. Sometimes you'll have musical ideas that will later be put to film. It's a bit rarer. But if we have a scene with a sad lad who longs for a girl, it's easy. Way, way, swelling orchestral music in a minor key. Boom, you've scored a film. If you're smart, you'll call back a theme established earlier in the film that represents their relationship. Brilliant! But what do I do as a composer to score a scene where the director isn't in direct control, but the viewer, without sacrificing consistent tone? Pacing is incredibly important in an effective score, but a player bumming around can completely ruin that. If the music is trying to telegraph tension, but you're trying to figure out which one of these darn buttons allows you to use gadget 755, or which one of these outfits will deliver the best charisma stat for the coming dialogue, you've completely lost your tone. One of the games that absolutely nailed supporting adaptive storytelling in a literal sense is Detroit Detroit become human. The story is set in the near future where our society has integrated highly intelligent androids that do most of the jobs that we don't like. The plot follows three androids as the nature of their being unravels, and it's pretty great, so I won't spoil anything. But the key selling point of Detroit Become Human's gameplay is that the plot details change dramatically with every choice the player makes, including plot points changing in accordance with the player's successes and failures. Here's the kicker: not only did they hire a different composer for each one of the protagonists, giving each character a distinct musical identity, but depending on the player's choices throughout the game, the scoring for each changes to represent the character's respective attitude towards their world. If the game is over 40 endings and branching arches within the storytelling, it stands to reason that the music needs to do something similar. Our score needs to evolve. The predominant method of scoring a modern video game is the use of adaptive music. This makes sense, especially in the case of free roam games where the mode of gameplay can change at any moment. There are a bunch of subtle ways that developers accomplish this, which I'll get to later, but first I want to talk about horizontal and vertical beat sequencing. Now, in the 80s, gaming looked like this, and it was only just becoming something that mainstream audiences would have access to at home. Home computers could just barely exist in the same room as a book without running out of processing power, and it was fine. But the music, unfortunately, was almost always completely static. At least it was, until these mad lads at LucasArts developed the iMuse, which was an adaptive music system that allowed the developers of Monkey Island and subsequent games to have scores that changed depending on what the player did.
But at that time in the industry, the tradition really was to play a cue for a minute or two, and then the player would experience a half hour, 2 hours of silence, and then you get another cue for a minute or two. And it just seemed like games could have a lot more than that. And so we made the fairly radical commitment to, quote unquote, when Monkey Island 2 came around the next year, to actually pave the game in wall-to-wall music, and in the process to make the music conform to the gameplay experience as closely as we could. And those two commitments were really the motivation behind iMuse.
This might seem novel, and we completely take that for granted now, but notice how the music here changes as you change rooms. It's subtle, but it's definitely there, and it's noticeable to your subconscious. This is horizontal sequencing. Event triggered equals musical event, new music. Cool. This is not completely different from how film studios directed music to be played to silent films before we started syncing entire original scores to film. Music had to change dynamically, live. A modern example of this can be found in the plantation scene in Far Cry 3, where that obnoxious dubstep track progresses as your character grows through the mission. Probably the easiest example of this is combat music. You have serene music. Oh wow, life is so calm. Oh, it's a, oh, look, a puppy. Oh, here we go. Ooh. Skyrim did a surprisingly smart thing by having its combat music for dragons be different from other combat situations. Generic combat? Dragon! Generic combat. I am the Dragonborn! They bring back the main theme. It functionally serves as a leitmotif for the Dragonborn and his central conflict. This can get repetitive, but it works well in longer, more slowly paced games. Another great example is from The Cycle. As of making this video, it's still in early access, but it's already a pretty great game in my book. It has a really enjoyable primary gameplay loop that I won't get too deep into, but the basic point is that players drop into mine the hostile planet for resources, reactivate generators, and hunt alien monsters and escape the planet before the cycle hits. Now it's there where the music gets cool. The matches are 20 minutes long, and in the final minutes the music switches to the main theme. It's this really heroic theme that's written in a 5/8 time signature that immediately ratchets up the tension and excitement as the end of the game draws near. The environment grows increasingly hostile and the skies go dark, and these hopeful intervals reminiscent of like superhero themes in cinema, combined with a slightly tense time signature that reflects the tone perfectly. Whoever did the music for this game deserves a raise. Again, as long as the different modes of your soundtrack aren't too repetitive or too grating, horizontal sequencing is a really effective way to tell these stories. But vertical sequencing has a little more to it. Instead of swapping out finished pieces of music, it inserts layers of music and production as the player does certain things. This happens everywhere. Notice how this Mario game adds bongos to the soundtrack as you mount Yoshi. A great example of this is the game Portal 2, where there are these subtle additions to the instrumentation as you get closer and closer to completing the puzzles. And there are so many examples of this. This might be the closest that video games get to giving leitmotifs to the player's experiences. The Batman Arkham trilogy is one of my favorite examples of adaptive combat music. There's a really cool video by Game Informer where Nick Arendelle breaks down the compositional and recording processes they followed for the Arkham Knight.
This is for the cop combat, so we would probably start with something like this, like the strings, a bit of choir, and then as you took down more of the thugs, we could bring in other elements. Bring in more synth elements and percussion. We'll add more intensity. As the combat gets more intense, we'll add more of those layers, or we'll get rid of layers if you're not having such a good time.
This shows how you can achieve that cinematic feeling without forcing the player's mood. I've been replaying this trilogy and it's genuinely moving. It's really rare to hear a video game franchise keep a cohesive musical tone throughout 80 plus hours of gameplay without it becoming stale. In film, a composer is able to use motifs and themes to represent characters and locations. Batman did this really well, but subtlety is key. We've discussed how gaming can do something similar to film, but it can't be as definitive with its score. Because just as repetition can be effective in emphasizing the storytelling, it can also make things feel stale due to the amount of hours one spends within this medium. In Rick and Morty, we are introduced to the character of Evil Morty with this piece of music that then continues over the credits, breaking convention. A season later, we follow the story of what we are made to believe is a different Morty, and as he is revealed to be a bit more nefarious, this piece of music fades in. We don't need him to wear a name tag, we don't need a title card, the music is able to turn subtext into text. So the question we need to ask is, does this kind of thing happen in video games? Maybe. Now, some of you might be shouting in the comments, sound design isn't the same as musical scoring, music is all... And sound design is the boring, like, background noise and stuff. Sound design is done by a different group of people entirely and should be seen as a different thing. Peter. That argument certainly has merit. There definitely exists this rivalry within the development of films and other media between film scoring and the other sounds in the film because they have to share the sonic space. But it is precisely for that reason that the two disciplines should technically be working together. Imagine if you were working on a film and the guys who do the special effects weren't allowed to see the film, or that they couldn't have any contact with the director. But for some unknown reason, the people who do the sound design have almost no contact with the people who do the music. It's crazy. But to those who say that music and sound design are two different things, I would ask you, what is music? Define it. I'm not trying to be silly. Try. Define music. Yeah, we separate music into genres, but we technically put the score for Stranger Things in the same vague category as the score for Forrest Gump, even though they use different tools entirely. Why is sound design any different? There's a reason EDM producers use that very word to define their process when they make their instruments. To quote a fellow YouTuber who was quoting someone else, music is defined as a series of organized sounds. Is this music? It's intentional. It's composed. It has not only a temporal component, but pitch. It's music. Another way we could define music is a group of experts that make sounds to fit a design. How does this relate to gaming? Well, one could argue that the player is allowed to be a part of crafting the audio experience. An absolutely insane amount of effort is put into each and every sound in video games. Every gunshot, every piece of crumbling bridge, every footstep has to be recorded and created and lined up to be triggered in response to the player's actions, or the actions determined by the script. Foley is a big part of film, but video games make everything way more complicated. Explosions, cars revving, the hum of Nirnroot in Skyrim, the sound of fire in Far Cry 2 becoming more and more all-encompassing as it envelops more and more of the environment. That rhythmical of mining in Minecraft. Actually, anything happening in Minecraft really is an excellent example of how audio can make even the simplest game design foster an attachment. I can't say how many times me and my wife replicate the zombie sound or the villager noises. These things are integral to immersion. But perhaps most significant are what I will call dynamic auditory scenario shifts. I mentioned various clips that are triggered when something happens, but something we don't notice as often are changes to the auditory realm we find ourselves. The lazy one is the filter that happens when one is near death in a video game or in danger. The sound becomes muffled and then returns if things normalize. But less obvious is this example from Red Dead Redemption's Dead Eye mechanic that changes the filter to show Arthur's focus. In this case, it's not merely muting certain frequencies, but removing parts of the instrumentation and adding different ones. The mind palaces in Detroit Become Human is also a really good example of this. We are shown not only the character, but how they are perceiving the world around them. Or the muting of higher frequencies when one is in a shield of some sort. The audio of NPCs' dialogue being heightened when one's character focuses. The little glitches in the Assassin's Creed games as your character desynchronizes. Even footsteps changing as the environment changes from familiar to foreign. All these audio changes are brought on by the choices of the player or the place the player finds themselves, and help paint a clearer picture of where they are and how they should feel. And is that not what a great score does? This is also very similar to another profoundly effective tool in creating an immersive world, the use of diegetic music. In short, there are two kinds of scoring in a piece of media, diegetic and non-diegetic. If the music is created in the universe, it's diegetic. Sometimes films will play around with this idea by sliding between the two. This is one of my favorite examples, and it is out of the Guardians of the Galaxy 2. Talk about their homes. And here's a girl. It's kind of been done to death, but in this case, it serves the plot. This piece is not only significant to these characters, but to our protagonist through his connection to his mother. In a similar way, Assassin's Creed Black Flag, aka a great pirate game being forced to be an Assassin's Creed game, aka the Pirates of Caribbean game Disney somehow couldn't make despite having all the money.
So it would seem.
Black Flag is these really cool sea shanty tunes that your crew sings from time to time as you sail the seven seas. Arg me matey! In Red Dead Redemption 2, you'll occasionally return to camp hearing your friends celebrating in song. One of my absolute favorite games, and subsequently one of my favorite soundtracks, is Alan Wake. It combines screechy horror ambiences with the soundtrack of original music from the band Poets of the Fall. A lot of the music is delivered in-game by these radios you find scattered all over the place, and I won't spoil it, but the music literally plays an integral part in the plot. This technique, admittedly, isn't subtle, and it's the kind of thing that really doesn't work in film. Something that blew me away is the way Naughty Dog did the guitar playing in The Last of Us Part 2. I'm not even gonna go into the whole score, cause that's like a whole nother video for a different day. As a guitarist, I love the fact that they made her fingers move the right way. It makes these moments feel real and clumsy instead of like an overproduced pop song recording. And it sells the fact that these aren't just musical numbers, but emotional scenes that we, the audience, need to be paying attention to. Now finally, what happens when the music, instead of taking the back seat to support the gameplay, takes the seat right next to it? Now, this has quite a lot to do with genre. When you think of genre of a film score, it's almost always some variation of orchestral. And because our technology has evolved past bleeps and bloops, we can use any instrument or genre to evoke any feeling we want. Let's take the phenomenal score for Doom and its sequel, Doom Eternal. You don't need me to tell you that Mick Gordon did an exceptional job, but it's not just the heavy down-tuned electric guitar. There are so many synth parts, many of which were done with a frankly insane amount of effort using analog synthesis. There's a really cool series of videos where he breaks down the whole thing, and it's really fascinating. For the sequel, they not only use massive choral vocals, but an actual choir of metal vocalists. This would obviously be a little out of place in most soundtracks. But the soundtrack doesn't just support the experience, it is integral to it. They expanded on traditional scoring ideas and then pretty much just kicked them off a cliff, employing various randomization techniques, making each sequence literally unique from a musical standpoint. That leads me to a very important point, and it's kind of the reason I made this video. Active scoring, a narrative moment with set music, is really rare in gaming. But this moment in Red Dead Redemption 2 perfectly outlines the strengths of active scoring. At this point, Arthur has lost friends and lost faith in the man he sees as a father. His whole world is falling apart. He's realizing the man he used to trust most isn't the man he once knew. All hope is lost, but amongst all this, he needs to stand unshaken. This is the first instance where lyrical music is created non-diegetically, and it's an entire 3-minute song. The game prompts you, the player, to put the ride in cinematic mode, relinquishing control, because this is the first time Arthur gets to process everything that's happened to him, and so should you. The significance of having a predominantly instrumental, very ambient score, then subverting that with a piece with lyrics 50 hours in, has to do with sub-vocalization. Sub-vocalization is the voice in your head that you hear when you read or that you are telling yourself to equip a different weapon. You see, when your brain has to do a lot of work, there will never be lyrics in the background of a video game score or a film unless it is supposed to be the focus, because it overrides the part of your brain that is trying to talk with itself. That's why you have to pause when a YouTuber puts an annoying text dump on screen while they're talking. This takes the music from being supportive of the subtext to being the text itself. It takes a seat in the front of your mind so you can focus on it. To all the musicians that have non-musician friends, have you ever tried to show someone a cool arrangement of a song and then instead of listening to the arrangement, they just start yelling along with the lyrics? That's because English is the language they know and understand. That's why it's such a risk having well-known pop songs in movies or video games. It has the potential to pull you out of the movie or video game because you have an existing memory of the piece of music. Don't get me wrong, this can be done to great effect, but it has to be intentional. In Red Dead, the combination of giving you the choice to sit back and be in the moment and giving you the brain something else to focus on makes the music jump to the front without breaking immersion. And honestly, it's the tip of the iceberg when it comes to the game's soundtrack. It is an immensely dynamic score that uses all the techniques we've discussed in this video to make what is, in my opinion, one of the best examples of effective musical storytelling. In a weird way, I feel like video games have more in common with music than it does with film. I don't think it's a coincidence that many professional musicians show a profound love for the medium, and many of the best composers have gravitated towards working in interactive media. I mean, what is music if not a form of entertainment where the continuation of the narrative depends on successfully pressing buttons? Thank you so much for watching this video all the way through. This was a bit of a passion project. This video probably took me like 3 months to make. I want to thank my wife. She is actually the one who initially had the idea for this video and has been supporting me through what has undoubtedly been the hardest and longest edit of my life. The sheer amount of screen capture footage and like clips that I had to find online to show all the things that I wanted to show is absolutely obscene. I really enjoy making these long form research heavy video essays, even though most people don't watch them. I actually don't know if this video is gonna do well yet. If you've made it this far, you clearly love music quite a bit, so let me know what is your favorite soundtrack, be it video game or other media. I do read all the comments. I don't have enough views yet that would be a problem for me. The irony is, I spent so much time on this video about how much I love video games that I haven't been able to play any video games. Goodbye.